Well, hey, Harvest, how are you this morning? You know, I'm really excited because I think summer might actually be here. I don't know, I'm not a prophet nor the son of a prophet, but I believe that we might have summer coming soon, and I'm really excited about that. My kids are finally out of school. They go to Chicago Public Schools, so like literally they got out Thursday. I know that's weird, but we're excited about that. I hope you have some vacation plans, some time of refreshment, some time of rest. Those are really important, even spiritual disciplines, not just to take time off and run around a water park, but to take time off to reflect on what has the Lord been doing in your heart this year? What do you need more of the Lord, and where do you need to grow? Those are important reflection and refreshment pieces, and I hope you're taking advantage of those when you take some time off of your work to get time alone with the Lord. And one of the things that I'm really, and our pastors are really hoping for in the life of our church is a greater dependence on the Lord, a greater stirring up of our faith. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. That's what we're going to be talking about the whole summer is this new series that we're beginning today. We're calling it Unsung, and it's regular people, ordinary people, and uncommon faith. And so today is a little bit of an introductory message to the whole summer, and we're going to be talking about faith. And now, if you had to go to one place in Scripture to talk about faith in people's lives, where would that be? Hebrews 11, that's great. Either you know that or you looked at your bulletin notes, either way, but it's good. So turn over in your Bible to Hebrews 11, and I'll meet you there in just a moment. But this is the Hall of Faith, as it's been called, and all throughout the book of Hebrews, you know, anytime we study God's Word, you don't just sort of rip it open and find a verse and then just read that verse. You want to know kind of the context, what's happening around the passage that we're looking at, because that really helps us know what is the author's intent, what is the Lord trying to tell us. I like to ask the question anytime I'm reading a passage of Scripture, why is this here? And to know why it's here, you have to know what it's in the context of. And so the whole book of Hebrews, the author is telling us that Jesus is greater, that he is a better prophet, that he is a better high priest, that he is a better rest for God's people, that he is a better covenant, that he is a better sacrifice. And then we get to chapter 11, and the author is telling us the way in which we tap into this superiority of Jesus Christ, the way that we do that is by faith. That's the way we tap into this better Jesus, this better sacrifice, this better high priest, this better covenant. It's through faith. Faith perseveres. It leaves behind the old. It clings to God. It believes the promises, so much so that it moves not just from a belief, but into an action in my life. It affects the way that I live because of the faith that I have in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your word, your perfect word. And we know that every single piece of your word is inspired. It's breathed out by you. And so, God, we would pray that you would breathe that into our lives today, that we would leave being changed by your word. We would leave being changed by your Spirit working through us. So illuminate the text to us today, Lord. Have us to grasp all of the things that we can from your word so that we could be better followers of you, that we could be more people of faith. So transform us by your word and by your Spirit today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Hebrews 11, we're going to read 1 through 3. He says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it, by faith, the people of old received their commendation. By faith, we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of the things that are visible. This chapter is known as the Hall of Faith, as I already said. And what follows these verses, if you notice even in verse 4, says, by faith, Abel. He goes into this list of faithful saints of the Old Testament. And this is the account of these believers and their incredible faith in God. But before the writer even gets to this Hall of Faith, he says, notice in verse 39 of chapter 10, just before the passage that we read. He says, but we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. Persevering faith is the trademark of those who follow the Lord. The increasing and the ongoing faith in your life, that is the marker, that is the fingerprint of the Lord upon your life for those of us who follow the Lord. And so first, persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. Persevering faith anticipates God's blessing. He says, verse 1 again, now faith is the assurance of the things hoped for, the conviction of the things not seen. Now, we have used the definition for years here at Harvest that faith is believing the word of God and acting upon it no matter how I feel, because God promises a good result. Faith is taking God at his word and it's directing our lives according to it. So it's not just this idea that I believe some things, that I have a list of things that I read in scripture and I've made my list and I sort of intellectually believe that these things are true. It's more than that. It's I'm banking on those things. I'm living my life according to these principles that I see in God's word. I'm believing on the basis of the reliability of the one who is trusted. Because God said these things, because Jesus Christ has lived these things out, that's what I'm placing my faith and my trust in. Here, it's what we have is not necessarily a definition of faith in this passage right here, this first verse. This is far more a description of what faith looks like. He's saying, this is what faith looks like when you live it out. These are the results of faith. It's the assurance of the things hoped for, the conviction of the things not seen. First, this assurance of things hoped for. The idea here, the word, actually means a guarantee. It's the idea that my faith rests on something secure, on someone secure. We're not saved by our faith. We're saved by what our faith rests upon. And that's a very important delineation, because our culture would say, you just need to have faith. You just need to be really sincere. You know, as long as you're genuine in whatever you're seeking after, that's okay. Garbage. That's not what Scripture says. What Scripture says is we're saved by our faith in the promises of God. We're saved by our faith in the fulfillment of his promises, which is Jesus Christ upon the cross for each one of us, that his death, burial, and resurrection paid the penalty for my sins and cleansed me from all of that unrighteousness and brings me into a right relationship with Jesus Christ. That's faith. That's biblical faith, what it's talking about here. And the assurance that we have, this guarantee that we have, that's our faith working out. We're not saved just by our faith, but what it's resting upon. And then he says the conviction of the things not seen. Just as our physical eyesight produces conviction or evidence of visible things. If I'm standing in the middle of the road and I see with my physical eyes a car coming towards me, I'm pretty convicted about what's happening and what I should do next because my eyes see it. That's the conviction that I have to jump out of the way. The physical eyes look to that. Our spiritual eyes, that's what faith is. So just as physical eyesight produces conviction, evidence about visible things, faith is the organ with which it enables people to see the invisible order. I'm able to see the way that the Lord is at work. I'm able to see how he's been faithful in the past. I'm able to see his promises that he has in Scripture and to believe that those will come to pass because I'm using faith, this organ that I have, just like my eyes. Oswald Sanders said, faith enables the believing soul to treat the future as present and the invisible as seen. I'm able to treat the things that God has promised, the things that he's told me in his word. They're secure. They're not going anywhere because I know that he is secure and that he can be trusted. We sang earlier about the faithfulness of God, and we read so many of these passages. I was so encouraged by that. But because of God's faithfulness in the past, he's proved to us that he is faithful for what he's promised in the future. And we can bank on these things. We can have faith and believe in these promises that he's made. That's the conviction that we have. Now, if you flip through this passage, we're not going to read all of chapter 11, but you should do that this week in a way to really prepare yourselves for this series that we're going through this summer. But Noah, in verse 7, think about the things that Noah was told and the promises that he was given, but he didn't see it, not with his eyes, not till much later, but he believed on those promises. He was able to see it by faith. Abraham, called out of the place that he knew, away from his family, promised that he would have all of these children, the stars in the sky, promised a land, but he left all of that. He didn't see all of that with his eyes, but he believed God. He stepped out in faith. Moses, in verse 24, he turns away from the Egyptians the way that he's been raised and said, no, I'm going to be about what God's word has to say. I'm going to be about leading God's people in the way that he's done that, leading the people through the wilderness. All of these trusted in God's promise. They didn't see it with their physical eyes, but they saw by faith what God would do and what God would promise to do. Look at verses 13 through 16. This is so encouraging to me, of chapter 11. He's talking about all of these people, all of these patriarchs. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had the opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. Faith is the confidence that you have a better possession than you see right now with your eyes. That you have a better and an abiding possession because of Jesus Christ and because of what God has promised to us. If you long for the type of Christian life that others want to imitate, if you long for the type of Christian life where you're growing in trust and dependence and hope and joy and love for others, it's a life of faith. That's where it begins. Seeing things with spiritual eyes that we're unable to see with our physical eyes. Believing the word of God and acting upon it. No matter how I feel, because God promises a good result. My wife and I are blessed with a couple of crazy kids, and we love them to death. Our oldest son, Judah, is here in the service. And after we had Judah, the doctors told us that, you know, without some jumping through some hoops with fertility treatments and things like that, you're not going to have a baby. It's not going to happen again. So my wife and I were really encouraged about adoption. The more we heard about it and learned about it, we were like, we want to do that. We want to be about that. And so we began this journey of moving forward with adoption. And any of you who have family members or who have done this, you know, it's kind of a long process, and it's a very expensive process. I have a pastor's salary, and it's like $25,000 to adopt, usually. And so we were saving as much as we could and going through this process, fill all these massive amounts of paperwork and things like that. We're in this process, and we got to the spot where our church was actually in a building campaign at the time, and you know, we were each praying about, like, what would you have us to give? And my wife and I were praying about this separately. And so we have this amount of money that we have saved, but it's like earmarked for adoption. That's what it's for, you know. And so we were praying and praying, and we both kind of had like a number in our head. Okay, we want to give this, you know, because we were convicted by the promises. If you read in Malachi 3, you can't outgive God. It's actually the only place in Scripture where he says, test me in this. Now, so that's a piece for me. Like, do I really believe that? Do I believe God? When he says, test me, you give your little bit, I'll open the windows of heaven, not necessarily financially, but pour out blessings so that there's no more need. That's what he tells us. And so we got to this point where I'm like, am I really going to believe that? So I'm like, all right, Lord, I feel like we should give to this. I'm really supportive in this. And so, you know, my wife and I came together, and she threw out a number, and because I'm, you know, a pastor and very holy, I was like, no, that's way too high. But the more we prayed about it, the more I was convicted that that was actually the number. And then I got to the spot where I was like, okay, God, I see in your word what you promise. I see what you tell us that we should do, and to say, test me in this. And I got to this spot where I was like, so am I really going to test the Lord in this? Am I really going to step out in faith with what he says? And I thankfully listened to my wife, and trusting the Lord, stepped out in faith, and didn't know how we were going to pay for adoption then. Like, we just, Lord, I know that you can provide. And I think it was 5 days after we made that pledge, that commitment of those resources, we found out we were pregnant. Doctors said it couldn't happen, you know, but we did. Elias, he's downstairs. You can go meet him later if you want. But just such a blessing. We were so encouraged through the whole process. We ended up adopting later, and the Lord provided in miraculous ways for all of the finances. It's just, but all of that to say, we stepped out in faith. It did not make sense to me at the time. When I looked at my bank account and when I looked at the things that were going to be expected of us in the future, it didn't add up. It didn't make sense. But God's word made sense to me. And we stepped out in faith, and God answered that prayer. And many of you have stories like that where you felt a little scared, a little uncertain. God, how are you going to make this happen? But listen, when we take the time and we take the intentionality to, Lord, I'm going to believe what you say, and I'm going to orient my life around that, God works in miraculous ways, and God provides for us. If you long for this type of life where God is working and you have the stories of a faithful God, it starts with faith. It starts with dependence on him. It starts with taking that step into the unknown and trusting the Lord for it. Every blessing that the Lord has for us is on the other side of faith. Every blessing is on the other side of faith. And persevering faith anticipates God's blessing in our life. And secondly, persevering faith receives God's approval. You'll see verse 2 again says, for by it, for by faith, the people of old received their commendation. These people that we see in chapter 11 that he goes on to talk about, they received God's approval because of their faith. Their decisions, their actions, they reflected a stance in their life that's the hallmark of faith, and they demonstrated the capacity of faith to sustain steadfast commitment to the Lord. This is the piece of approval that the Lord gives to them. You'll notice this word commendation, it's actually used 7 times throughout Hebrews, and 4 of them are in this chapter, chapter 11. And it always refers to the witness of the biblical record, this God's word giving witness to it, indicating that these characters, they received the praise of Scripture. Scripture's talking about them in a positive way, and that shows that thus God is approving of their action. God is commending them. He's giving his approval to those who act in faith. And this summer, as I said, this series is called Unsung. And what we wanted to do is, you know, the book, this chapter, again, you should read that this week. This is your homework. This chapter has so many really cool, amazing stories about people of faith who stepped out. And, you know, he says at the end in verse 32, what more shall I say? Time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah and David and Samuel and the prophets who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped with the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in its deserts and mountains, in dens and caves of the earth. These incredible stories that we have of people of faith who step out and receive God's approval. And he says, time would fail me. He's like, I'm running out of ink here. I don't have time to tell you about all these. But the really cool thing is we have the whole summer. And so we're going to spend the whole summer talking about some of these people of faith. And what we're really encouraged by the pastors. We all sat in a room with Pastor Dave Stone and came up with this series and thought through all of the characters and things like that. So what we're going to do through the rest of the summer is each and every week we're going to look at a character in Scripture. And we've called it Unsung because we want to look at some people in Scripture that we don't talk about a whole lot, but to hear their stories of faith, because around every one of these rows and on every one of our campuses, there are people in our church of great faith, that the Lord places his approval upon you because of the faith that you have. And you won't have your name in lights, and people won't send you thank you cards all the time. But listen, God has his approval upon you because of the faith that you have. And so many of these people in Scripture that are just, there's just a couple verses about them, but we can hear about some of these people, the approval that God has, and we can be encouraged by them. So here's a few of the ones that we're going to talk about this summer. We're going to talk about the four men who tore the roof off of the house, lowered their paralyzed friend, down in Mark 2. We're going to talk about the woman who was suffering with the issue of blood in Mark 5. We're going to talk about Barnabas. We're going to talk about the thief on the cross. We're going to talk about Rahab. We're going to talk about the woman at the well. We're going to talk about the owner of the donkey in Luke 19. We're going to talk about Mephibosheth. Yes, you heard that right, if you don't even know that one. This is going to be a really cool story. Mephibosheth, and we're going to talk about Mary, Martha's sister. So many of these people that we can glean truths from God's word, and we can emulate these people of faith as they stepped out and received God's approval. I want God's approval. I want God's commendation on my life. How amazing would it be for, like, maybe Hebrews 14, to be written with your name about the way that you stepped out in faith in your life, to hear God's faithfulness placed upon you, and him to say, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your master. That happens through faith, and we want God's commendation. Here in Hebrews 11, this hall of faith, these believers who were commended for their faith, they didn't have what they were seeking yet. They were trusting in God. They didn't see it yet. Verse 39 and 40 says, "And all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect." What he's saying is they're all looking forward to this promise, but they trusted in the Lord to provide for them. You'll see in another place that the blood of bulls and goats, these sacrifices that they're going about, all of the Old Testament, you read through Leviticus and Numbers and all of the specifics about the way in which they're supposed to sacrifice, all of that is by faith. All of that is looking to Jesus Christ, who would be the perfect sacrifice. And they didn't have it yet. They didn't see the promise. They only knew of the actual promise and not the fulfillment of it. They're looking to a greater sacrifice, Jesus on the cross for us. And our faith in that sacrifice of Jesus Christ is how we receive God's approval. Verse 6 says, "Without faith it is impossible to please him, for whoever would draw near to God must first believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him." Listen, there's not anything that we can do. You can't be good enough. You don't deserve God's approval, and neither do I. But our faith and our belief in Jesus Christ is the thing that God places his approval, his commendation upon us. Is your life marked by faith? Faith in what you don't see yet, but faith in the promises that God has made to you. Would the people who know you, would they describe you as a person who is filled with faith, or a person who's lacking in that? Because persevering faith is what receives God's approval. And lastly, persevering faith knows God's power. Persevering faith knows God's power. He says in verse 3 again, "By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of the things that are visible." He uses creation then as an illustration to tell us a little more about faith, about what that looks like, and about how God's power is at work. When you think about creation, a little side here, doesn't really matter how old you think your parents are. They weren't actually there when the world was created. Don't know if you knew that. I felt that way sometimes, but they weren't there. We can't actually see creation happen. You can't, even though some have tried, you can't sort of recreate all of that. You can't go back to a time when that had happened and actually test that. It does take faith to believe in what you don't see. It takes faith to believe that God created the heavens and the earth. It also takes faith to believe that all of this came from nothing. You can't recreate some of the other things, the origin of the world, the theories for that either. We can't test those kind of things, but we believe based on what we see and what we know. We sort of believe in the evidences that we see. You can't prove creation. You can't prove any of these theories of the origin of the earth, but we can see a whole lot of clues to it. We can see a whole lot of evidences to the ways that God is at work, a lot of fingerprints that are on the handiwork of the Lord. A good detective can go to a crime scene and look at all of the clues and spend the time examining all of the things that they see and can determine what happened based on those clues. The more clues there are, the more guaranteed the person is of what actually happened. And there are a ton of clues to this idea of creation that he says, but it's by faith that we understand that the universe. But there are a lot of clues that we see. Here's just a couple of those clues. If you want a more in-depth look, there's a couple of great books, Case for Creator by Lee Strobel, New Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell. They go through a lot of these. If you have further questions, you want to delve into some more of these. But here are just a couple of clues that we see from the natural world that would tell us, I think this is true. We can have faith to believe that God created the heavens and the earth. The first is the sun. The sun is like a giant nuclear engine. It gives off more energy in a single second than all of mankind has ever produced since creation. It converts 8 million tons of matter into energy every second. Has an interior temperature of more than 36 million degrees Fahrenheit. I know you feel like you want that when it's January, but it's hot. If the earth was any closer to the sun, we would burn up. And if it were any further away, we would freeze. It is perfectly aligned in God's choreography. Here's another example. This, you might want to turn away if you're squeamish to these kind of things, but the golden orb spider, pound for pound, the silk of this spider is 5 times stronger than steel, and it's twice as strong as the best bulletproof vest that we can make. In fact, due to its strength and its elasticity, it has been said that you could trap a jumbo jet with the spider silk that's the thickness of a pencil. That's crazy. We can't manufacture things like that. But God made it in a tiny little spider. God's handiwork, his creativity in a tiny spider. Third, the human eye. This is a truly amazing phenomenon. Although accounting for just 1/4,000th of an adult person's weight, it's the medium which processes some 80% of the information received by us. The tiny retina contains about 130 million rod-shaped cells, which can detect light intensity, transmit impulses to the visual cortex of the brain by means of some 1 million nerve fibers, while nearly 6 million cone-shaped cells do the same job but respond specifically to color variation. The eyes can handle 500,000 messages simultaneously. I can't handle two. The eyes can handle 500,000 messages simultaneously and are kept clear by ducts producing just the right amount of fluid with which the lids clean both eyes simultaneously in 1/5,000th of a second. It's crazy complex. This is what Michael Behe, who's another great author, if you're looking for some of these things, has a book called Darwin's Black Box. He calls this idea, specifically with the eye as well, he calls it irreducible complexity. that there are elements in the natural world that you can't reduce to something simpler. You couldn't have had part of the eye that then evolves into a greater part of the eye. You needed the whole thing for it to be able to work at all. And so here's a quote specifically about the eye. I believe we have it on the screen too. Suppose that the eye, with its inimitable, easy for me to say, contrivances for adjusting the focus to different distances, for admitting different amounts of light, and for the correction of spherical and chromatical aberration, suggesting that this could have been formed by natural selection, seems, I freely confess, absurd in the highest sense. Charles Darwin said that. Romans 1:20 tells us that his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and his divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. The beauty, the order, the complexity, the goodness, the creativity in all the world that we see. These are evidences that God created the world out of nothing. But what this passage is calling us to is to have faith in that. And the faith that we have, you can take all of these clues. You walk to the crime scene. You examine all of the clues. It makes sense. But we don't see it happen. We still have to have that element of faith. And when we look at God's word and we read all of the promises that he gives us, it makes sense. But we still have to take that step of faith to believe the word of God and act upon it, trusting that God promises a good result. We need to trust him through all of these things. Verse 3 is a specific illustration of these characteristics that we see in verse 1. The assurance of the things that are hoped for. The conviction of the things that are not seen. Our faith and our belief that God created the world out of nothing is a way in which we look to the evidences in action and have faith in those. Listen, God's greatest truths for us, the greatest promises that he has for us, they are all discovered by a simple faith. That's why Scripture talks about the faith of a child. It, regardless of how much you know Scripture, regardless of how much you study the natural world, it takes simple faith in a perfect God who's faithful to his promises. He has been faithful in the past. He will be faithful in the future. And these greatest truths that God has for us, they're discovered by this simple faith. It's how we see God's power at work all around us in the world. It's how we see God's power at work in my life. If I haven't stepped out and taken those steps of faith, I never would have seen God be faithful in those things. If I hadn't tested the promises of God in that way, I wouldn't be able to rejoice that God's power is at work in my life. This whole text, and really this whole summer, has us asking the question of ourselves, when was the last time that you acted in a way that only makes sense if all of God's word is true? When was the last time that you looked across the landscape of your life, the decisions that you've made, the way that you've patterned your finances and your schedule and your who you hang out with and all that you do? When was the last time that you looked at that and made a decision that only makes sense if God's promises are 100% true? We should all be able to point to times in our lives that, like, it doesn't make sense if this doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense if God isn't faithful. That's what I'm leaning on. That's what I'm going after. So as we study this year, this summer, about these people of faith, the ways that we can be stirred up in our own faith, my prayer for each one of us is that we are grown in a deepness of our dependence on the Lord. That when we get to the end of August, we would say, I trust the Lord more. I'm trusting in his promises more than I did back in June. And I'm laying all of my life down because he is faithful to us. Isaiah 7:9 says, if you are not firm in faith, you will not be firm at all. Let's be firm in our persevering faith. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your promises to us. We're grateful for the stories of the saints of old and what we can learn from them. God, we're grateful that you are a God who does speak to us, who makes these promises, that you are a promising God and a God who keeps those promises. Lord, we trust you for each of these promises that you have made. We desire that you would enable us to step out in a greater way this summer. God, grow our faith, grow our dependence on you. We will give you all of the praise and all of the glory for the things that we have seen and the things that we are yet to see. God, we trust you for it all. God, when have we stepped out in faith? When have we depended on you and you've let us down? Never. But every time that we have stepped out in faith, stepped out into what might be a little uncertain for us and a little fearful and a little, it doesn't make sense apart from your word. God, you have shown yourself strong. You have shown yourself faithful. You have shown yourself to be immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine. So God, do that in our lives today. Do that in our lives this summer. Let our faith be stirred up as we see the promises of God fulfilled in the people of old and as we step out to see them fulfilled in our own lives. God, we give you ourselves. We trust you for it all. And we thank you for your strength and your faithfulness to carry out your covenant promises in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.